so much for that special, man, that didn't light your fire and your woods wet, amen? Man, that was wonderful. So I'm so glad to be part of that. And I done kind of told everybody what tonight's topic was. We looked at, do you need to be revived this morning? And tonight we're looking at what is a revived church kind of look like. And just I mentioned a few things this morning, and we're going to look at a few tonight and kind of see and just think how wonderful it would be if everybody was revived and focused on serving God and focused on doing the right thing and actually putting Christ first and just completely doing the way we should be doing things. And so we're going to look at that this afternoon. So Ephesians 3, chapter 3, verse 21 is where we're going to be going to kind of the book of Ephesians, the church Paul wrote to the letter to the church at Ephesus. And it's just such a outstanding letter, which I know all the Bible is outstanding, but it's an outstanding letter to the church there at Ephesus, telling them and just uplifting the people and telling them what they need to be doing and how they need to be acting and how they need to be serving God. And so we're going to look at that as kind of a jumping off point, because many in today's world just want to kind of degrade the importance of a New Testament church. There's ideas out there that, well, I can worship on the lake, or I can worship at a barbecue, or I can worship wherever. And while you can honor and glorify God through much of what you do, God expects His people to be coming together in His churches and worshiping together, because it's so much better together. So we should not look down on the New Testament church or degrade the importance of it, but we should appreciate what it means to be landmark churches and realize that the local visible New Testament church was created by Jesus Christ Himself. He came down, started Himself, and if Jesus thought enough to start it and loved it enough to die for it, we ought to love it enough to show up, right? And so that's what kind of we're going to be looking at. So Ephesians 3, later verse 21, just kind of jumping off here, says, unto Him, speaking of Jesus, unto Him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus throughout all ages, world without end, amen. And so there can be the case made that Jesus Christ expects His people to give Him honor and glory through His churches. And so let's go ahead and open up in a word of prayer. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank You so much for this night and this time to come, to be in Your house, to be with Your people, to celebrate Your Word, to just read it, Lord, and I ask that You use Your Holy Spirit to help us apply it to our hearts, and let us be revived, Lord. Just each and every one of us as individuals, let us be revived. Let this as a church be revived. Let this community be revived, and that everybody just come back to life and realize that life is only worth living if we're serving You, if we're living our lives according to Your will, if we're bringing You honor and glory, that the purpose of our life is to follow You, to love You, to worship You, to praise You. And Lord, we just lift up all that's around us, lift up the sick, lift up the immorality that's in this country, Lord, asking that You be in control, and that our leaders, that they would turn to You, and that they would put their faith in You, and that they would guide and lead and direct and govern this country according to Your word. And Father, we just ask that You touch our hearts and help us to leave here loving You more than when we arrived. Lord, we ask that during business meeting later that everything be done and said according to Your will, and that You ultimately receive honor and glory through all that we do. Father, we praise You and we love You. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. And so we're looking at what is a revived church. Look at there in Ephesians 3:21, it just points out that Jesus and God are going to get glory through His churches. And so what is a revived church look like? Now, if you went around and took a survey and then filled out a Family Feud type survey and walked around to 100 people and asked them, what is a revived church look like? Now, just as a whole, as a world, as a community, people would give you answers like, oh, they've got a wonderful music service, or oh, they've got activities for the kids, or oh, they would all be these worldly answers. But that's not a revived church. I mean, there's nothing wrong with some of those things, but the focus has to be on the Word of God. And a revived church, it's all about the people, and it's about their love for God, and it's about a relationship with Him. And so a revived church needs to be awake. So we're going to look at Romans chapter 13 is where we're going now. And one of these days, I remember that about a month ago, when I talked to Brother Stan and a few others over the internet, someone asked me about preaching. I said, oh, I like the expository preaching. And for some reason, ever since I said that, God has had me do topicals all here. So I don't know what that's about. But we are going to look at a lot of verses tonight, realizing and looking and learning what a revived church is. And so we need to be awake. Is the first part, Romans chapter 13, starting with verse 11. And it's interesting that this afternoon, several people came in and asked my wife, did you get a nap today? Did you get a nap today? And she may have, may not have. I think we did for like 3 seconds. And then she woke up. And you know what she did when she woke up? She cracked the whip and put me to work, getting that house going. Now, that is such a great illustration of what God wants his churches to do. He wants them to wake up and get to work. Amen?
Amen.
So that's why we need to be awake. Romans chapter 13, looking at starting with verse 11. If I get there. Romans 13, starting with 11, says, and that knowing the time, that now is high time to awake out of sleep, for now is our salvation nearer than when we believe. The night is far spent, the day is at hand. Let us therefore cast off the works of darkness, and let us put on the armor of light. Let us walk honestly as in the day, not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and wantonness, not in strife and envy, but put ye on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make not provision for the flesh to fulfill the lust thereof. He's saying, as we realize we need to wake up, and in today's world, the churches of God need to wake up and realize that it's more important now than ever that we get active, because time is drawing near. We only have so much time, and if I told you you had X number of hours to get something done, you better not wait around. You better get going. You better get active, and we can look around and realize the time is drawing near. We need to be active. We need to be working. We need to be serving. We need God now more than ever. Just say it like that. We need God's churches. We need God's people. We need that love. We need that commitment. We need that closeness. We need that warmth. We need that fellowship. We need that now more than ever. But, you know, we also need to be awake and paying attention. You know why they say you don't need to drive sleepy? Because you're going to fall asleep and veer off the road and hit something, right? And that's not good. So we need to be awake, and God's churches need to be alert and awake and realize that the world is coming after us, that the world is getting bad, and that there are false teachers springing up all over the place. Let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter 16 and going over to verse 13. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, looking at verse 13. We may read verse 14 too. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, starting verse 13. Paul, writing to the church of Corinth, says, what ye, stand fast in the faith, quit you like men, be strong, let all your things be done with charity or with love. And so he's telling the church to watch and pay attention. Watch means your eyes are open, you're paying attention, you're on guard, you're looking around. The time of this thinking everything's going to be okay is over. We need to realize, like the early church realized, that we do have enemies in the world, that the world does want to shut us down, but we have a God that is bigger and stronger, and he wants to keep us open. He wants to keep us active. He wants to keep us serving. He wants us to be together. And so, like Paul here is saying, watch ye stand fast in the faith, means to stand strong in the faith, not compromise, but go completely by. In our world, Paul didn't have the completed Bible, but we do. In our world today, we stand for what the Bible says. We do not change, we do not bend, we do not compromise, we do not give in. If the Bible says it, it's true, and we stand for it. If someone doesn't like it, they can take it up with God.
Amen.
We have to stand for the Word of God. So watch ye means to pay attention, stand fast in the faith, quit you like men. And there may be a misunderstanding there. It doesn't mean quit and sat down to do nothing. Quit you like men is an idiom there. In Greek, it means be a man. We have a lot of problems in our world today because real men don't stand up and be real men. And so it says, be a real man, stand for the faith, be strong. And verse 14 sums it up on why you can do that. Let all your things be done with charity. A revived church does all things with love.
Amen.
Love is the center of your relationship with Christ. Christ loved you enough to die for you. We should love him enough to live for him. And we should do all things with love. We should serve one another with love. We should show up with love. I hope everyone here is here because you love Jesus. I hope you're here because you love Lakeview Missionary Baptist Church. I hope you're here because you have that love in your heart. Now, we're not going to turn there for time's sake, but Jude 1:3 talks about contending for the faith. We are going to have to realize that we are in a war and we have to contend for our faith. And what's really heartbreaking, there's a lot of so-called Christians that are veering from that. You know, it's one thing to realize that the world is out there and we have to love the world because we have to witness for the world because the world needs to know Jesus Christ and get saved. But we have to at the same time be on guard because there are people out there seeking to destroy us, just like Satan who's seeking to devour us like a roaring lion going to and fro. We have to be on guard for that. But it's really bad when our own Christian brothers and sisters fall into lust and fall into temptation and fall into false teachings and they come at us and stab us in the back. It happened, and I wish I could go there, but not. Paul was backstabbed by some of his own people. He had people that loved the world more and walked out on him and left and went their own way. But he continued to fight the fight. He didn't let it get him down. He continued to stand for the faith. And so while we may have our brothers and sisters turning, we need to be on guard for that. But we keep doing what we're called to do. We keep walking the straight and narrow. We keep serving. We keep going because we're doing it for Jesus, not for us. We're doing it for Christ. And so we have to focus on that. And so the revived church is awake. A revived church is watching. And a revived church is paying attention. But what another thing a revived church is united. Now, I have been in churches. We've been to lots of places. And you could tell there was something in the air. And on one side of the church was one group. One side was the other group. And come to find out, they fought all the time. That's not a united church. That's not a united body. That's not a united group. The body of Christ. Well, let's turn there. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We're actually just a page or two backwards. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. Looking at verse 12, and you could really read from 12 all the way to 31. But we're not going to. Just look at verse 12 and 12. It says, "For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ." The church is to be a united body with Jesus Christ as the head. And if the body is all working together, and there's diseases in our world that cause your body not to work. There's some of you that have different ailments. As you get older, things don't work like they used to. Right? Can agree with that. I've been told that I'm not getting older, but I have heard that when you get older, things don't work like it used to. You don't say a word. Things like that don't work. Sometimes your body doesn't work. The things that you used to do when you were younger, when you were 30, you could get up and work day and night. Now that you're 58, you get overheated really fast. It happens, and it just wears you out, and you just don't know what's going to happen next. The body fails, but the body of Christ should not be divided like that. There should not be diseases in the church house. There should not be fights amongst members. The body is supposed to be pure and working together for a central goal, and that's serving Jesus Christ and fulfilling the Great Commission. And so if the body, if everybody is united and in the same mind and the same heart for the same purpose, for the same goal, the church can do a lot through the power of the Holy Spirit. The church can do so much. And so you need to be united. And so a revived church is united. Now let's look at just a couple of verses about what united means. So let's go to Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6, we're going to look at verse 10. How we need to be doing good for one another. Galatians chapter 6, verse 10 says, "As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men." And then he even goes one step further. He says, "Especially unto them who are of the household of faith." So Paul here tells the church of Galatia, yes, we should be taking the opportunities to do good to all men, but especially we should be doing good to one another. And there's other verses that say we should prefer being around one another. We should look after one another, carry one another, and take care of one another. Because as the body is, we are supposed to be a united body taking care of one another. Which leads us to Romans chapter 12. Go to Romans chapter 12. Romans chapter 12, verse 4 and 5. And if, I don't know if you've ever seen, there's a picture out there of a group, and it's this big wagon. And some of you may even know what I'm talking about. Have you ever seen like a horse and buggy? You got a horse and you got a buggy, and then you hook the horses up and they pull the buggy. You could do the same with an old-fashioned plow or a wagon. The horses are pulling the same direction. Now, if you took your buggy, plow, or wagon and hooked the horse up going this way and the other horse going that way, they're not going to go anywhere, are they? They're just going to pull and pull and pull and wear each other out, and then you've got two tired horses and nothing done. And it's the same thing. We need to be pulling together in the same direction. Romans 12, look at verse 4 there. It says, "For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, so we, being many, are one body in Christ, and everyone members one of another." And you realize that we're all united. We're all one body. We're all together. And you know what? We all need to be functioning. Going back to the picture of your body, and that's why Paul used that. If your fingers don't work on your hand, then your hand doesn't work. Then your whole arm doesn't work. And then you have to do everything on the other side of your body, left side of your body. And you look at that, and that's why Paul's saying we are a united body. We need all to be functioning. We need all to be working. I've heard, and I was told this by a gentleman, and when he first told me it, I laughed because I thought, well, that's good. And then as I've pondered it, I've realized he's pretty much accurate and right. He said that all churches have 100% participation. All churches have a 100% participation. 10% doing the work and 90% willing to let them. Now, as you ponder that, you realize he's probably accurate. But it should not be that way. Many hands make light work. There's a proverb for you. Many hands make light work. And you say, well, I'm older, or I can't do this. We had a great example yesterday as Brother Troy held that door open for everybody. And you say, well, that's such a simple thing. You know what? When you're carrying furniture with both hands, that door being open makes a world of difference.
Amen.
Makes a world of difference. And so there's nothing in here that anyone can't do that's not a benefit to the glory of God. If all you can do is pray, that's wonderful.
Amen.
Man, we need prayers. I hope and pray that you're praying for us. We need those prayers. And so there's nothing that's too small that's not a benefit to God. If you can pray, if you can, whatever you can do, as long as you're doing it with a loving heart for the benefit of Christ, you're doing good. And so we need all people doing something. And so we need to be united. And let's look at the early church. Let's turn to Acts chapter 2. This is kind of the early church example, and I've had people tell me, well, that was a one-time thing. And you know what? I think the early church was united in love and was on fire. I don't see no reason why we can't be united on fire as well. Now, look at Acts chapter 2. Go to verse 42, and we're going to read down through the end. The early church, and remember, they were under scrutiny and faced imprisonment, stonings, and death if they got caught doing a lot of what they were doing. So it's not like they were in an easy, bubble, perfect world. We have it a lot easier than they did. But they did it. Listen to what they did. Verse 42 says, "And they," speaking of the early church, "and they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and in breaking of bread and in prayers, and fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done by the apostles, and all that believed were together and had all things common, and sold their possessions and goods and parted them to all men as every man had need. And they continually, daily, with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved." Every time I read those verses, I can feel it in the air. People are like, oh, I hope he don't say let's start going to church every day. Because that's what people see. They continue daily. Well, you know what? I wouldn't have a problem if we continued daily. But that's not necessarily just a worship service. That is a united front. Notice what they are. They are united for the common purpose of serving God. It says in verse 46, yes, they continue daily with one accord. Notice that. They were with one accord, united, one purpose in the temple. And he dropped down to verse 47. It says, praising God and having favor with all the people. They were with one accord, and they praised God, and they were loving and united. And notice what God does there at the end of verse 47. And the Lord added to the church daily. You know what? It might be worth showing up every day if people were added every day. Yeah. You know, they used to have revivals, and I know that sounds like an older speak. Oh, they used to. You know, we have revivals today, and the new trend is to have three-day revivals. When I was younger, you had to have at least a week. I've been told 40, 50, 60, 80 years ago when they had a revival, they'd go for a week, and at the end, somebody would stand up and say, I say we go another week, and they'd have another week, and another, and they'd have a three-week revival, and 100 people would get saved.
Amen.
Why can we not do that today? You know why? Because if we had a three-week revival, there's not many would actually show up the whole 3 weeks. That's the sad part. It's near impossible to revive the world until we can revive God's people. Amen. And so a revived church is awake. A revived church is united. A revived church is in love. We need to be in love with God. You can look at Mark chapter 12, verse 30. It says, love God with all your heart, mind, body, soul, and strength. We need to be loving God first and foremost, as that song Brother Stan sang this morning about love and your heart. And we need to be loving God. And when your heart is full of love for God, your actions and your daily life is going to be focused toward Him. And so we need to be in love with God, then we need to be in love with each other, as we talked about, united, and we need to be loving the lost. We're not going to sacrifice our time to witness to somebody unless we love them. When we start realizing souls are dying and going to hell because we're sitting still, then we might fall in love with them and start telling others about Jesus. So a revived church is awake, a revived church is united, a revived church is in love, and you revive churches full of servants. Church is not about coming here and seeing how we can serve you. It's about coming here and seeing how you can serve God. It's about seeing how you can serve Him. So let's look at John chapter 14. John chapter 14, looking at verse 15. John chapter 14, look at verse 15, and this is everybody. Everybody always, and I say everybody, I should not generalize that term, but if you go around this country, if you had time to go witness to lots of people in America, most people in America, or at least in the southern states, will say, oh yeah, I know God, or I go to a church, or we're still a Christian nation according to polls. Because most people say, yeah, I know God. And they always talk about, oh, I love God and God loves me. And then you come to this verse and they go, uh-oh. Because what does that verse say? Chapter 14, 15 says, if ye love me, Jesus speaking, if ye love me, we have so many people in today's world say, I love Jesus, I love Jesus, I love Jesus. What is 14, 15? If ye love me, keep my commandments. So many times people want to, they love the love part of Jesus. They love the fact that He loved them and died for them and can give them eternal life. They absolutely love that part, but when you turn it around and say, okay, if you love Him, serve Him, come to church, be a part, be active, be faithful, suddenly it becomes a little problematic. They like the genie in the bottle that sits on the mountain, that when they need something, they go to Him and get what they want. They like the ideal of God, but they don't like the actual, real parts of God. They don't like the fact that the Bible steps on their toes. They don't like the fact that coming to church, the preacher's always preaching against sin and telling them to straighten up and telling them to live right and telling them what they did Saturday night was wrong. They don't like all the discipline part. They don't like the work part. They don't like the sacrifice part. They don't like the service part. Basically, they make themselves a god. And so I know this country is considered a Christian nation, but I wondered if we truly got down to the nitty-gritty, would it really be? I think we can see all the things going on that the answer would be no. We're in a moral country. Immorality is rampant. And you know what? Read the Old Testament. Read about Israel. And read about about how they had turned to false gods. They had turned to religions that made them feel good. They had turned to doing whatever they wanted to do and see what God does to them and realize that our judgment day in this country is coming. The fact that we allow abortions to run rampant, the fact that we allow immorality to run rampant, we have a judgment day coming. So we better have Jesus Christ as our Savior so that we can be prepared for that day. Just like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, just like Noah, just like Moses, just like Jonah eventually, just like all the Old Testament prophets, God didn't keep them from the punishment, but he kept them through the punishment. So we need to realize that. So a revived church needs to be awakened, united, and in love. We need to have a servant heart. We need to be willing to serve one another and serve God. And then finally, a revived church actually puts the Great Commission to practice. Matthew chapter 28. Let's get a reminder of what the Great Commission is. Matthew chapter 28. If you ever want to know what the church's marching orders were, Jesus leaves it right there before he ascends. A revived church is an active Great Commission church. Matthew chapter 28, starting with verse 18, it says, "And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, All power is given unto me in heaven and earth." And so then he tells them what to do. He says, "Go ye therefore." First off, we have to be active. As we said this morning, we have to be willing to go out those doors and live our life of discipleship and a living testimony and live a life of witnessing through those doors. He says, "Go ye therefore," and it says, "Teach all nations." That's teaching them the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's teaching them that Jesus loved them, that Jesus came down from heaven, that he lived a perfect life, that he was the Son of God, that he's the Savior of the world, that he loved them 2,000 years ago, that he was nailed to the cross, that he came out of the grave, and that salvation is through him only. That's what teaching them means. It says baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. That means to bring them in, baptize them into the church, make them a church member, and then it says teaching them to observe all things. That means discipleship. That means Sunday school preaching, training, Bible training, teaching them the rest of the Bible. That first teaching is teaching them the gospel so they can be saved. The second part is after the Holy Spirit's inside of them, after they've been baptized and joined the church, then and only then can you open up the rest of the Word of God and teach them. Until a person is saved with the Holy Spirit inside, the rest of the Bible is almost impossible to understand. Or it is impossible. You may know the stories, but you won't appreciate what it means. But once you're saved, once you're a church member, then it says teach them to observe all things. That's where you teach them how to change their lives so that they can have a changed life that is leading and following, and an example is Jesus Christ. And so a revived church is an active church. And notice Jesus then leaves them with a promise. He says, "Teach them to observe all things whatsoever I've commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. Amen." A revived church realizes Jesus is with us, and with Jesus with us, we can go anywhere and do anything that's his will. Yeah. If it's his will the church grows, it will happen. The people, if it's his will that you become active, if it's his will, if you follow him and get behind him and let him lead, let him guide, let him strengthen, let him comfort, and let him do his thing, and all you have to do is be active and honest and willing and honest, just go. Just like Noah. I love Noah. God tells Noah to build an ark. The ark did not just appear. A lot of people in today's world say, "God, I need this done and I need it now." If God called to Noah today, Noah would sit there and expect God to do the ark himself. No, God called Noah. God told Noah to build the ark. God gave him the instructions, gave him the directions, supplied all the need, but Noah had to get out and build. Over 100 years. But the day it started raining, Noah realized the work was worth it. And we kind of have that same thing. We may work for the next 10 years. And everybody wants to focus on numbers. I notice there's not a number board in this sanctuary. That's kind of nice. A lot of people focus on numbers. You know what? If we work for 10 years and one soul is saved, can you honestly say it's not worth it? That one soul may be your child or grandchild. I don't know. That one soul may be your neighbor, maybe a stranger that walks in the road, but we should love them enough that one soul is worth it.
Amen.
Because a revived church is a soul-winning church. So this morning I asked if you need to be revived tonight. I've just been kind of looking at how great it would be to be a revived church. A revived church that is awake. A revived church that is alive. A revived church that is focused on Christ. A revived church that is united. A revived church that is in love with each other and in love with God first and foremost. A revived church that is servants and the whole church is actively serving in some capacity. A revived church where people are going out and winning souls and bringing converts in and getting them trained and showing them the love of God. Wouldn't that be wonderful?
Yeah.
Man, that would be wonderful. So, if we're going to have revival, we must first get our hearts right with God as individuals. Then, and only then, can we really be revived. We need families pointing their families to Christ. We need men pointing their families to Christ. We need women pointing their children to Christ. Then, through the church, we can truly begin to serve God. We need to ask ourselves, have you gotten yourself right with Jesus Christ? Let's look at that verse for a second. Let's turn to Romans chapter 10. Sometimes I think we underappreciate the power of the written word of God. We can talk about salvation, but sometimes just reading the words of God is the most powerful testimony we can have.
Yeah.
Romans chapter 10, starting with verse 9. Says that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Amen.
Isn't that wonderful? For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. That means if you're sitting there tonight and you're under conviction tonight and you realize that you're lost, you realize that you need a Savior, and all you have to do is believe that Jesus Christ is the Savior of the world and call upon His name. And there in verse 13 it says, whosoever shall call upon His name shall be saved. If you're sitting there tonight under conviction and you believe in Jesus Christ, call upon His name and ask for salvation tonight, and leave here tonight saved and knowing you are saved.
Yeah.
Oh, how great that would be. So first, before we can have revival, before you can have revival, you need to know Jesus Christ as your Savior. Then, after you're saved, we have a few questions. Is Jesus leading your life? He cannot be just on the back burner. It can't just be something you do on Sundays. If you really want to be revived and you want to see people saved and you want to see your churches grow, you need to ask yourself, is Jesus leading my life? And then ask yourself, do you want Lakeview Missionary Baptist Church to actually serve God? If we're united and you're part of the body, you need to be actively serving. If you truly love this church and want to see it grow, are you pouring your heart out in prayer to God? Ask yourself, when was the last time you truly prayed so hard to God that tears ran down your face? You know, when Jesus was in the garden, He prayed and tears of blood was running down His face because He was pouring His heart out. I believe that God's people today, if we truly want to move past just simply talking about revival, wishing for revival, we need to be praying for revival. Pouring our heart out to God. There is nothing ashamed with crying your eyes out to the Lord.
Amen.
That means you love Him. That means you love His churches. That means you love His people. Do you want to see Lakeview serve God? Do you want Lakeview to give God honor and glory? Do you want to see this church grow? Do you want to see this church thrive? Not so that we can build massive buildings, but so that we can worship God together. So that we can see souls saved for Jesus Christ. not about the worldly possessions. All this stuff is nice, but it's about seeing souls saved. It's about seeing lives changed. It's about seeing disciples made. If all of us would unite together and pray that, earnestly pray that daily, we may see a revival. I'm asking you, are you doing your part? We need all pulling together. We need everyone doing their part. What God's going to call me to do, going to call my wife to do, have Brother Stan do, have Brother John do, what God has all of us do is going to be different for every one of us, but none of us can do the job for everyone. What God's asking you to do, you need to do your part. And so tonight, as the song leader comes, the musician comes, I ask you again, if you don't know Christ as your Savior, what is stopping you, what is holding you back, what stumbling block is in your way, there's nothing worth holding on to. Give it up. Move past it. Call upon the name of Jesus Christ, and tonight you can be saved. And child of God, I ask you again, are you truly pouring your heart out? Do you want to see a revival? Do you want to see lives changed? Do you want to see souls saved? Well, it starts with your heart. Get your heart right tonight. Pray to Jesus and pray, Jesus, I want to serve you more. I want to follow you more. I love you. I want to obey your commandments. I want to see this church grow. And just pour your heart out to Jesus tonight. As we stand, would you do that? Pour your heart out to God. Just go to Him and let's all make the decision tonight that we are going to leave here serving God completely. Will you do that tonight as we sing?
Number 563.
We thank you for this time that we've had to praise you, to worship you, Father, as we just
move on to the business meeting. We just ask that everything be done according to your will, that is Christ-centered, Christ-focused, and that all decisions are made in love, made united, and that you ultimately receive all honor and glory. Father, we love you and we praise you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Brother John, come